Okay, hello everyone. Thanks for joining us tonight for The Making of Pearl with the Academy Award-winning Patrick Osborne. Pearl is the first VR Oscar-nominated short, and those of you here at the stage tonight are extra lucky because you'll have a chance to check out the VR version on the Vive right here in a little bit. We've been test-driving it here at Noman all afternoon, and it's so awesome, so I'm so happy that you'll get to see that. And we've been so lucky to have so many incredibly talented award winners at Noman lately. If you were here last week, last week's guests from Leica, they went on to win a VES award that very night, and they've also won a technical award from the Oscars after the Kubo event last week. Patrick, he's not only an Oscar winner, but he's also just won 3 Annie Awards for directing, music, and production design for a broadcast production. He's also the creator and director of the Academy Award-winning short film Feast. He served as animation supervisor on the Oscar-winning short Paperman and animated on Bolt, Tangled, and Wreck-It Ralph while at Walt Disney Animation. So let's have a big round of applause for tonight's amazingly talented guest. It's also Patrick's birthday today, so we're especially honored that he's spending the evening here tonight. So as if we're not lucky enough to have a presentation by Patrick, the chance to experience Pearl on the Vive, we have 5 amazing gifts for you. So those of you with raffle tickets, please hold on to those. They're super exclusive vinyl records with a cool little Pearl guitar pick inside. So hold on to the tickets. We'll raffle the 5 winners at the end of the presentation just before we open up for the VR demos. We do have a prize for live stream viewers, too. We'll have a 1-month subscription to the Noman Workshop up for grabs. So if you just share the live stream event URL on Twitter using hashtag Noman, and we'll pick a winner later. We'll take audience questions as well after Patrick's presentation. So here on the stage, please raise your hand. As always, we'll bring the mic to you. On live stream, or if you're watching on Facebook Live, please use hashtag Noman on Twitter, and we'll do our best to read some of those out later on. Okay, so we're going to drop the lights, and we'll kick off tonight's screening. Oh, sorry, tonight's event with a screening of Pearl. Thank you.
Day, September 4th, take 2. No long way home. I hope you dream, don't feel small. And when the wind begins to rise, I hope your mast stands straight and tall. These are fragile times, we blur the line. The unlikeliest of places, we all find a little grace. There's no wrong way home. One winter coat, 2 wild eyes, all the unspoken love that you're carrying inside. These ain't the calmest days, but you like it that way. Won't you rest a while in the storm's peaceful eye? It ain't where you've been, but where you're going to. It's not where you're from, but where you belong. And there's no wrong way home. There's no wrong way home. The spiral shell, the golden mean. You see, you're just the sum of those who have been down this road before. You were expecting more. Won't hurt to rest a while. A soft shoulder by your side. It's not where you've been, but where you're going to. It's not where you're from, but where you belong. And there's no wrong way home. There's no wrong way.
some bread for laughter and one for fear. I tied them both together because it was always windy here. And don't take this wrong, but I never knew. Were you watching over me? Was I watching over you today? Where you been? Where you going to? It's not where you're from, but where you belong. And there's no wrong way home.
You didn't do anything wrong. You're just sitting in the car. Let's give it up to the parking lot. It wasn't a big deal.
Thanks for coming, everybody, and thanks for watching online, I guess, if there are people out there. Sorry I was a little late. It's my birthday, and I was in a meeting, and at the end of the meeting, they brought out a cake, and I was, like, ready to drive here 40 minutes, you know, from Fox, and all of a sudden, there's a birthday cake in front of me, so I couldn't just skip out. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what it's like to make something, VR film thing. No one really knows what to call it these days. And I'll start a little bit about how I came to meet the people at Google Spotlight Stories and how this whole thing started. So that's me working at the computer. Adam Green, an animator who I shared an office with for about 5 or 6 years, did that. And I spent a lot of time at Disney trying to make things that felt like that were CG and high tech and kind of current in their techniques, but that felt more connected to the artist, that were more directly more what you see is what you get as you're working, instead of this kind of process of waiting on the computer and realistic rendering and all that I felt like takes so much time and it separates you. So working on Paperman and Feast, both of those, the intent was to make things that look non-photoreal, but still feel kind of naturalistic and impressionistic in their style. And Pearl is kind of a real-time attempt at doing something similar to that visually. So when I started thinking about this project, it really came to me during this. I was on the festival circuit for Feast, showing it in Annecy, which is an amazing animation festival in the French Alps. It's on a lake. It's a great place to just be in June in general, but it's really cool because it's animators and that's it. It's a whole French town in the Alps overrun by animators and showing animation. And you go there and you meet all kinds of people making shorts and films in our business, and it's really cool. And Jan Pinkova asked if I would have lunch and talk about possibly doing something with them. And Jan directed Jerry's Game, the Pixar short with the chess player, and Ratatouille was his original concept as well. So we sat down, and there are way too many people in Annecy that week for the restaurants to keep up. So we sat down for lunch. We sat there for 3 hours, never got lunch. We just got like two beers and had to leave because we moved on to some screenings. But he said, you know, think about doing something with Google Spotlight Stories 360. At that point, it was like through a phone. It was the idea of telling a story through the window of a mobile phone and using, they believe that you can use mobile technology to tell good stories. So the idea of, like back in college, when I was like one of you guys or some of you guys, the idea of being able to make shorts and get paid for it and like and keep doing that as a career seems crazy. It seems like something you make a student film and then you move on to work on feature films. But with the emergence of all these kind of new technologies, funding and the ability to make creative, independent shorts is kind of around again, which is really cool. And I always thought in school, if I ever could do that as a career, that seems like a great thing to do. So I couldn't really resist at least entertaining the idea of that. So I said maybe. You know, I was still working at Disney at the time. But, you know, it's one of those things where you want to at least entertain the idea of seeing what you might be able to do with this 360 thing. So I started thinking about what I would want to tell with that format. And VR wasn't quite a thing. There was like the early Oculus was out as a dev kit, but I'd never played with one. But I knew it was kind of around, and people were saying, like, it's filmmaking is different in VR, and you can't edit and all that. And I kind of wanted to do something that still moved time along, like an edit, but that in 360 you would still be grounded. So the idea came to maybe set it in a car. So it started with that, this idea that, you know, the audience is now going to be controlling the camera or the frame. So as a director, it's kind of scary to let go of the idea of having that ultimate control of a frame, but if you have the windows of a car, you're still able to get some compositional control within those windows. You get frames within frames. So for that was one thing that kind of attracted me to the idea of doing it in a car. And then the other thing was that if you cut from one scene in a car to another, as long as the steering wheel and the seat stayed in the same place, the audience wasn't going to really get lost. They would still kind of know what direction was what. And I think you could get away with time jumps with some anchors like that, and you won't like need the audience to look around every time a cut happens. So I start there. I'm like, okay, it's going to be a car, and it's going to take place over a long period of time. So you think, well, the car goes from like maybe a new lot to a junkyard. So maybe this is like a Giving Tree style thing, but an automotive version of a Giving Tree. Is there like I like the idea that we connect emotions to objects like cars. They mean more to us than just like a thing. Like people name them. My wife's car's name is Pearl, which is where all this kind of came from. But this idea that you also, like there are these heirlooms in a way too. Like when you first start driving in high school, usually your first car is like one that your parents kind of passed on, one of their old cars. So started thinking about all that. Road trip movies would be fun to kind of do one of those. And then I started thinking about passing on objects as well as talent and passion and taste. Like your parents don't just give you a car, they give you a kind of a framework of tastes and a framework of interests. And I think that's really nice. And there's maybe something in a story about a car passing on that, but also passing on taste. And I started thinking about that. So I love music. I'd always wanted to do some kind of folk musical. So if Spotlight Stories is willing to support this, I'm not going to say no to the idea of doing a folk musical. So I thought about that. The idea, like the kind of romantic idea of touring musician, seems kind of cool. I love that scene in Almost Famous where they're all singing in the bus. It just seemed like maybe there's these things were, they all seem to be spinning around a similar idea. And then I thought about what I've been passed on. And my dad was a toy designer for Kenner. That's me on the Care Bears box when I was two. And he does automotive art and toy design. And we used to draw together. And I feel like, you know, in 1991 or so, Kenner was, I grew up in Cincinnati where Kenner was at the time. And it was purchased by Hasbro. And they moved. Like everybody at Kenner either got laid off or they moved to Baltimore. And my dad didn't want to like move my brothers and I away. So he kind of gave up that career or that branch of a career working at a big toy company. So we would have a regular life. So I thought maybe there's something in there, but a music version of that. And this short could be kind of a gift to my dad. So all those things come together to sort of feel like something. When I talk about it in that way, I can kind of see where the emotional center is. And if I can find a story where the emotional center is there, and if I have dinner with someone or drinks and I can pitch it to them in a way that I can get them to feel that core, then I feel like I'm on to something that might work and it might be universal. So it starts there, and then I start to pitch it to them in that way, not any real tighter than that, just that it was about passing on musical talent and it all told inside this car. And they bought off on it, and they said, yes, let's try this. So this was April of that year, I guess about 2 years ago. And we started thinking about what to actually do. And at that point, I started thinking about how to structure this thing. And there's no real right or wrong way to deal with story structure. I think you just kind of find yourself. You find your way through a story. You find the key points that you really like, the things that you know that need to happen, and try to think about how it's going to structure. I knew I wanted to make it center around a song. So I thought, well, everybody knows the structure of a pop song where you have this chorus. You have like a verse, verse, chorus, verse, bridge, chorus structure. And I thought maybe there's something visual that can be done. So when I showed up at Google, they gave me one of their famous whiteboard rooms, a little conference room. And I started just kind of drawing out on the wall what it might look like. And, you know, it's, you never, I feel like story is kind of this nebulous thing until it's right. And it always feels like a little bit stressful and weird, and then you kind of lock in, and you try all kinds of different ways to try to get that lock in. So I wrote a script for this. It doesn't really have words or anything like that, but it's a way to just think about it. And then it was this crazy person chart that actually kind of finally got it to work for me, where I don't expect you guys to be able to tell what's going on here, but each of those little sections through the middle is like Sarah growing up, the girl in the story, and then where the verses and choruses kind of line up to stages in her life. And those are the lyrics to the song. So making sure the song lyrics and the stages of her life kind of, they're not exactly the same, they're not on the nose, but they're kind of, they related to each other in a way that creates kind of an interesting drama or tension. I'll zoom in and you can kind of see. And then these little, I kind of chart out energy and try to think about like as the life goes, is this energy building, and can we make the color choices and the camera choices and the action choices kind of support that energy build too as you go? And it's, again, you, no time to read all this, but you can probably find it online somewhere. And basically, it's just figuring out, making sure that we have dramatic tension in the story where our two main characters are kind of opposing each other in like what makes one person happy and makes the other one not. That kind of tension, I think, is the center of a lot of stuff, a lot of good story, a lot of good emotional stuff. So in the meantime, I knew this was going to be a musical, so we started reaching out to artists, trying to find people to collaborate with, and I got demos and ended up really loving No Wrong Way Home, which was by Alexis.
Together, cause it was always windy here. And don't take this wrong, but I never knew. Were you watching over me or was I watching over you? And it ain't where you've been, but where you're going to. It's not where you're from, but where you belong. And there's no wrong way home. There's no wrong way home.
I'll turn it down a little bit. It's Nikki Bloom and Alexis Hart and J.G. Weasler, the songwriters. I picked the song based on just seeing it against some of my drawings. And then Nikki Bloom was one of the other songs, but I loved her voice so much. And it turned out that on tour, she actually does this. Her YouTube channel has these little van. They're in the van singing along with a lot of their songs and doing covers. And it seemed like it was really cool that it was that it kind of felt like she kind of was the character in a way, so it was perfect that she ended up doing it. These are some of the early boards looked like at this point. Storyboarding in VR at the time, a year and a half ago, was not a thing. Now there's things like Tilt Brush that make it, you know, a little more possible to do this sort of thing. But this is the early sketch of this song.
I hope your dreams don't feel small. When the wind begins to rise, I hope your mast stands straight and tall. These are fragile times. We blur the lines in the unlikeliest of places. We all find a little grace. There's no wrong way home.
So just from that, I thought, it was only about a minute long of the song, but it seemed like the kind of thing that would really connect. And it felt simple and universal, like something you'd heard before, but in kind of a fresh way. So I started thinking about how to actually plan the show. And this became, you know, kind of difficult. I wasn't sure exactly how to think about VR or a film happening around you. And this is another one of those, like, well, maybe I can do this top-down thing and plan out the shots this way, like where the characters move, to make sure we're match-cutting, and that when you cut shot to shot, you're not leaving the audience looking around, that you're, like, giving them something to hang on to all the time. And then I tried to think about it maybe a little bit like theater as well. So if you're putting on a play, you know the audience sits facing a certain direction, and most of the stuff is going to happen in that direction, but every once in a while, maybe someone comes running down the aisle or something, and that seems to work in plays, but they always telegraph, like, oh, there's a noise back here, so that means look back there, and someone's going to come running down the aisle. So we started to think about things like that, too, in forming it. And then we had the next kind of almost obvious step, but maybe not, is to go and try to pre-visit. So this is me going in with the simplest versions of what the characters are and trying to figure out exactly how the whole show would play out. And the reason I did this is because this all had to run on a cell phone, and you needed it to be the simplest of geometry, otherwise the phone was not going to be able to keep up and there would be gaps between all the cuts. So this is really the only way you could watch the show before it was optimized well after our creative process. But I think it really helps to kind of have an understanding of where these characters are in 3D and actually pick up the phone and try it out. So the quicker we could get to on a device and testing things, the better. So with all that, all the story choices kind of working are in a place that feels okay, I start to think about design. And it had to run, you know, how do we get something that's beautiful, that feels like quality animation, but runs at 60 frames per second on an iPhone 4 becomes like the challenge next of the visuals. And I brought on Tuna Bora, who's an illustrator who lives here in LA. And she does amazing work, but I really liked how she could simplify and how she could make polygonal looking artwork really have kind of an organic and grounded feel. So I brought her on to help out, and so she was the first person that came on right when I was working on story. We reached out to a few designers. This is Oren Haskins, who did a couple passes at making our characters look nice. His grandfather was a famous fashion photographer, so he has this really cool sense of like style that's been in his blood for a long time. He's grown up with it, and really thought it kind of looked cool, and it was an interesting way to treat flat color and shape. And then Tuna would go in and kind of clean it up and make it work. We had a ton of characters for a short like this. There are some feature films that don't have, you know, this many characters fully rigged. And then we started doing that. So at Google, you do about, the Spotlight Stories, you do about a month and a half of proof of concept where you're just kind of testing things and playing around with the devices and trying to make little demos. And then, so that went from like April to the end of May. And then from June until about November, the summer before last, is when we actually went in and did the production. And it starts with designing everything. So from all those shots, I need to have the sets figured out and designed. This was all by Emmerich Kevin, who is an awesome artist who's working as a director at Riot Games right now. And other artists like Willie Rial and Kevin Ruan came on to fill us out. Overall, we had about 8 environment and character artists just figuring out how to make this world in a simple way that's beautiful, that would be able to run on a cell phone. And kind of, I call it a little bit like a impressionistic polygonal artwork. And I think it's really beautiful, and I think it actually is more interesting than photoreal in a lot of ways, because in photoreal you can kind of concentrate on the details, but I think when you have this impressionistic polygon art, you let the emotional state of the image sort of wash over you in a way, and it's not really, you're not really thinking about details, but the whole, just how the whole thing lets you feel. I think it works really well for this kind of stuff. So, and these are a bunch of Tunas. A little behind the scenes Tuna artwork to show what it looks like when she was painting over this. And we didn't really have great VR tools yet, like that are starting to come out right now. So this is all just her taking screenshots on a cell phone and then going into Photoshop and painting over them in the interest. And then we just hand them back to the modelers. There's 2 or 3 modelers there that kind of figure it out. So, but before we got to all of this stuff, we actually started in a direction that I thought was kind of the wrong way, and I'll talk about that a little bit because we're here at Noman. Like the missteps you make are kind of as interesting sometimes as the correct direction. So, like I said, when you first start there, we did this proof of concept, and this was the first thing that got on the phone based on the previous 2 scenes that you just saw, and it was clear that it really... first of all, it was taking way too much time to texture and detail everything, and it started to just look like a video game, and it didn't feel special to me in any way. So we kind of regrouped after that. We realized that, you know, maybe this kind of look here was not the best way to go with this amount of technology. We couldn't get it to look good enough running at 60 frames a second. So we decided to go back and try to figure out exactly how do we make it kind of stylized, what are we doing. So you need a guide first. So this is Tuna's first little level of detail guide showing how things can look at different distances. And then Cassidy Curtis came, and he was an animator at PDI for about 15 years. And he had done research in non-photorealistic rendering in the 90s, was really into it, and luckily he agreed to come onto the project, and we just started experimenting with how to break up the edges and how to take these color shapes that we were thinking about and loosen things. And these are all of Cassidy's, these are his, like, not mistakes, there's steps along the way. Some of them look good for different reasons, but a lot of them have various weaknesses that expose themselves in different ways when things are animated. It's really tough to get something non-photorealistic, like kind of painterly, to work on a moving character as well. So we had to have a technique that not only worked on simple primitives, but also something that works on characters as they move. And then another side of things is this whole toon shade disaster that I feel like... Toon shade takes silhouettes that maybe look good and then breaks it up into these really ugly default shapes that I just don't like. So we didn't want to have the computer figure out our light shapes. You want to be able to design everything. So we came up with a few techniques that let you be able to, first of all, make the edges kind of wobbly and rough and not perfect, and then second of all, to be able to control light shapes on characters with, not with literal light, but with pieces of geometry that intersect. So what Cassidy is doing is actually rendering out three buffers per every frame. One is a mask, it's a dark and light mask, and then one's a dark color and one's a light color. And the mask basically tells you, am I showing the dark or the light? And it's all completely hand controllable. So there's nothing, lights aren't involved at all in the whole short. It's literally just moving pieces of geometry around and intersecting to make the effect of light. On top of that, once you have all these tools kind of built, I think it's important to think about the Vive or on the phone. The audience might not be looking where you want them to look the whole time. So it became clear that I needed to find a way to tell the story in everything. How do we tell the story of these two living in the car? How do we make it kind of clear that maybe they don't have a house? Would it be cool if we just had all their possessions kind of pile up? So we tried to make sure that, as the story goes, that you see a little bit of a history. You see her favorite stuffed animal, and then she gets a few more. You see magazines and drinks and camping equipment and food, just to be clear that they're always kind of living. And then when they finally move into the home, they're taking that stuff out, and then from the rest of the time, the car is kind of clean until the band gets in there. So this idea that set design can actually kind of help tell the story, I thought was really helpful. It's good. It's great to do in film. It's even more important to do in VR because you're not guaranteed that the audience is looking at your character, and you're not guaranteed that the story is getting told that way. On top of that, you want to make sure that the color, the way you're dealing with color and light is also telling the story. So, and this is kind of a typical thing to do color pass for the whole film. This is something that Tuna did. But the idea we came to here is that, you make the memories a little bit rosy, and you make the drama, the teenage years, a little bit contrasty, and then you come back to the rosiness by the end. And I think just trying to think of it in a little cycle like that really helps to kind of unify artwork and story and all make it be talking about the same thing. So that slide is out of order because these are Tuna's. One of the things we also wanted to do is try to give it a sense of time and space. So a big part of the design work is also just coming up with fashion and how to make it feel like. We thought it'd be cool to do maybe 1983 to 95 time range, something that's far enough away that people can get a sense of it from fashion and from design. And so if you look around in the film, there's all kinds of cues into that. Some of this is the Space Girls, or Earl Jam, or Comfortable, or our favorite, Melodica. Tuna had fun kind of designing everything around this 90s idea. I think it's awesome. And then one other thing that's kind of a very specific thing to not only the headset VR, but the phone, having a VR, a sort of 360 sound that is accurate to the world is really, really important. It's just essential to make sure that people aren't getting disoriented in how they perceive the world. And, your ears tell you a lot about balance and tell you a lot about story, honestly, and it's really important to have that 360 audio be real and work. And one of the limits of the phone, not only can you not ray trace visuals on the phone, you also can't, the processors aren't powerful enough to calculate audio bounce. And for something where you're supposed to be in a car, where you're going to be hearing bouncing sound, it's really important that the sound of the character and the music in the car feels like it's in the space. So for that, Pollen Music, the guys who recorded this, actually got a microphone that's a spherical microphone, and they put it in a car, and they drove around San Francisco and recorded all of the shots with the car windows and doors in the appropriate spots to make sure that the 360 audio with all the bounce and everything felt right. So this is a really quick clip here of their of a little bit of behind the scenes of that.
One winter coat, two wild eyes, all the unspoken love that you carry inside. You see the calmest days seem like it that way. Won't you rest a while in the storm's peaceful light? It ain't where you've been, but where you're going to. It's all where you're from, where you belong. And there's no wrong way home. There's no wrong way home.
And that song is now being played on SiriusXM Radio 6 times a day. So it's pretty amazing that it went from a little tryout demo that we did in May a couple years ago to like actually being on his album and around there and heard in cars, like actual cars with people driving. It's kind of neat. I think that's where most people hear their SiriusXM coffee house. So anyway, I can talk about more of that stuff or take questions from you guys. And I can speak for hours on this stuff on VR and making shorts, or being an independent director in Hollywood now, if you want. So, any questions? Yeah.
So, you wrote the whole thing, too. And do you think it didn't make people better at the writing process, which is very connected to all of us, because it's all the stages, right? So it's a little different than a straight script, right?
Yeah. It's a question about what the writing process is. I'll repeat the question if there's for you guys, if that's okay. I would say that the beautiful thing about Spotlight Stories, and it's Google kind of funding. They're paying for artists to make really beautiful stuff. It's free, you know, on the internet. So, and it's free on Vive. So the development process is nothing like developing something for like television or a feature, and it's similar to shorts at Disney, where at Disney the short is an art project there too. It's not really, it's a prestige thing. It's not to not to make money, but the fact that Google is willing to support this stuff is really cool in the first place. And then when they go out to artists there or directors, they go out to all kinds of different ones to try to make stuff. Once you kind of agree on what it is you're doing, there's no real tether at all. There's no kind of, there's no notes process. There's no like approval step. You just kind of have to deliver on the promise. And in some ways that's a lot worse because there's no real check on you and you can kind of do it, whatever you want. But you realize that similar to pitching stories outside, you know, in any studio or a TV station, really all you're doing, like, you're not pitching to the money anymore, you're pitching to other artists. You want to make sure that you can get the best people to work with you. So you still have to be really on top of, like, the core of that story and what it means so that other people are willing to help. Because they're giving 6 months of their time to a project that's not ongoing. Like, after 6 months, the team disbands. So I found everybody on Twitter pretty much, all of the artists that helped, just from people that have reached out to me in the past about work or people that I've really loved their work and just kind of remembered. So that all gets into writing a little bit, because when it's on you, really it's like you have to be able to sit in a room like with this many people and get them all to be kind of excited about it, so you have to be excited about it. So the core of it for me was like finding sort of a simple beginning, middle, and end. A beginning that is easy to understand, which is like the father, daughter, who are homeless essentially because the dad wants to be a musician. And that that those two ideas aren't compatible in a way. Like, you can't really have, like, the best life for a kid is not the best life for a touring musician. It's just how it is. And I think that kind of tension is what makes things interesting for me. And then I love trying to find a way where, like, the right choice gets an unexpected and delayed result. You know, for Feast, it was a similar thing, where if the little dog, you know, decides to be selfless for a second, it doesn't seem like it's going to be a good thing, but, you know, a few minutes later, it works out that way through a series of events. So I think that's like, where I start. And, you know, I like the Dan Harmon way of thinking about it, where you kind of dip into a realm of uncomfortability. And for the dad in this, the uncomfortability is, like, not going after his dream, something he's always been doing, and to, like, stop doing that is that, like, dipping into that underworld of mystery. And the fact that you can kind of come out the other end and think you lost, but then your kid give it back to you because of something you gave them in the beginning seems nice. So I think having, like, a few little things in there, that's most of writing for me, is that. Even in a feature, it's still kind of, you want it to be as simple as that, because then everything can kind of hang on it. And I feel like pitching around that, you have to have that core or something there that you can kind of emotionally hook people with in order to even get started. So from there, it's just, for me, it's like whiteboards or note cards to try to figure it out. It's usually a mess until it's not. I wish it was like, it's the most stressful thing ever. Like, not having a story work, or knowing that a story is, like, close to working but not quite, is the worst. Because you just want, you want to get to the point that you know will happen eventually where it works and you like it. But it's a struggle all the time.
This is a great presentation. So I may have missed something. So the Google's Stories is really to watch it like this, right, on your phone. So how did it get to the VR, fully immersive, you know, Samsung, you know, Daydream, you know, helmet?
Yeah. I don't know if it's Daydream. I guess it probably would be. But so we started making it for 360, and then we realized in the middle that it'd be cool to do, because these headsets were kind of 6 months away, that we should at least, like, experiment. Like, we made it knowing that we might do that, but it wasn't a sure thing. And a lot of things had to be changed when that happened. So when we were actually making the film, we couldn't watch it. You can only watch one shot at a time because the phone couldn't load the next shot. So you would watch one shot, think it felt okay, but not really get a sense of, like, the continuity. So I would record every shot and then make a movie of that and play it back. And, like, you could capture the camera motion, just record off the phone, just to feel like, okay, this feels like it might work as we play it through. And we finished all creative, all animation, all design, before we could play the film back on a phone. So I didn't actually see the film work until about 4 months after the creative stuff was done, which is fine. It was just optimizing it, because, you know, all kinds of things had to be written to make that work. So then the Vive came out, and in one day they ported it to the Vive, and because it was running on a powerhouse, it didn't need any optimization. It just kind of, so that ended up being, like, much easier than the phone part, because once it ran on a phone, it could run easily on a, you know, water-cooled, you know, 980 Ti or whatever. So we didn't really know it was going to work that way, and then once we saw it that way, you know, you would watch people sitting there and watch it, and you'd realize that they're going to stick their head out the window, and there's no outside of the car, so we had to make the outside of the car. And then people would stand and look through the sunroof, and we're like, well, there's no, we need to put wheels and a roof and all that. Like, there's stuff that, you know, people just tend to do when they get the headset on that was not expected. And we also had to move the characters out of the passenger seat. So in the film version, there are characters in the passenger seat sometimes, and in the 360 also. But in Vive, it's weird because you're sitting on someone's lap. So you can't really keep a person in the passenger seat the whole time. But it wasn't really in the plan to do that necessarily. It was kind of there was a wave, and it wasn't too much effort to do it, so it seemed worth the experiment. And I think it's really interesting to see the film and then watch that and just see how they affect you differently, because some people think that's the way to do it and some people think this is, and it's kind of just how you want to watch something. And that made me wish that all the movies I've ever worked on I could like put on the VR version and just see, because it's just a different way of experiencing the content. But yeah, we made it for 5 formats in the end. So it's on theatrical edit, in which I motion captured cameras to make the film, and we edited it together traditionally. It's on Vive, it's on the Google Spotlight Stories app, it's on Google Cardboard, and it's on YouTube 360. And they're all different, and all kind of interesting in their own ways. But the, does that make sense?
Okay, we have another question here.
So I thought this was fantastic, and it was really interesting seeing Pearl compared to Feast. So one of the things that I was kind of interested in, though, is how did you go from having the kind of the backing of Disney to doing something independent for the first time? You said you found artists on Twitter. How did you kind of, where did you set up shop? How did you kind of bring the team together, and how did you kind of do all that?
Yeah. You know, it's, the Google Spotlight Stories has a crew there, like a core software crew and a few artists. So there's a little bit of support there, but it's not enough to make something like this. So we started there in Mountain View. I live here, but I would fly Burbank Airport 2 or 3 times a week, and I would get there faster than people that lived in Oakland, because 2-hour Google bus commutes, you know, it's like a 45-minute flight and it's like an 18-minute drive. It's not that big of a deal. But so we started there in Mountain View on Google campus for a while, and then we knew we needed a space that we could bring artists in and have them work. So half the crew, which about like 12 people, were at a company called Evil Eye, which is it's a visual effects company. It's about half the size of this room, and they have, you know, there's computers and desks there for people to work, and you know, it's an awesome little facility. They do a lot of they do feature work. They do kind of cleanup on things. They do all kinds of different stuff. It's a couple comp artists that run that company, so we use their space and. Half the people were there, half the people were just at home, wherever they lived in the world, and it was Google Hangouts and Shotgun, you know. I've used Shotgun for a long time. I think it's like a really, for this kind of thing, it's perfect, except for it's not great for VR yet, but I'm sure they're doing stuff for that. And it was just drawovers and Google Hangouts, so I could be at home, I could be in Mountain View. Tuna, the production designer, lives here too, so sometimes we would work in her space downtown, sometimes she would fly up. And it was just all over the world. So our character designer was in Australia. Another one was in Scotland. And another artist is in Paris. And then 2 animators were in New York City and Virginia. So it's the world now, as far as making content like this, most people can work at home just fine through Hangouts. We had some Hangouts that were like 50 people. You know, all these little faces. Gets a little bit unwieldy.
Cool.
Yeah.
We have another question here.
Thank you for coming. I have a question about the dialogue. Why didn't you choose not to include dialogue in between characters?
I think I like to try to make silent films mostly because they work anywhere in the world without really needing a localization translation pass, you know? So there is, I do like diegetic sound. I don't like it to be completely silent. I want you to be able to feel like it's like you're in the space so that people are speaking, but it's a little bit muffled. You shouldn't really be able to tell what they're saying. I just think it feels nice, and it travels better. That's all. Wish we could do more of that, you know, but.
Okay. Take this one first.
Yeah, hi. Just got a quick question at the pre-vising stage. So when you were like storyboarding and you were talking about there are certain tools now that if you were going to do that again, what would you use now? Like if it was tilt brush or quill or, and just thinking that back through with hindsight because it was amazing, but it was like, yeah, would there be a better way of doing that now?
For sure. I mean, I think I would have wanted to make our own tool, but it would be something like Quill, but with a timeline. Because I think you could probably storyboard in VR pretty effectively now, almost entirely with layers, the same way people do it in Photoshop, essentially. But you'd want to be able to like play that back and sit in the car and kind of look around. It would be amazing. Like, I think it would really help with the process and not be so much of a like trust me situation, because that's what it was. Like, no, I couldn't show anybody. I'm like, trust me, it's going to be good. I hope. And then you just lie to yourself and hope that you're not crazy. I like both Tilt Brush and Quill, but they're different. And I've tried out a few little animation tools. You know, the cool thing about the VR world right now is that people are very sharing. They're willing to share a lot. So if you can, generally, if you can find the creator on Twitter, reach out to them and ask for like the software, the beta that they're showing off or whatever. And people tend to share stuff a lot now because it's all this big community of people trying to make tools. And I actually think for me, gaming is fun in VR and everything, but like creating is like a next level thing. It's not even like, we've been making 3D artwork on screens for a long time, and it's time to like make it in 3D where it makes sense, you know. So I can't wait for like real, like the ZBrush equivalent to really work in VR. Right now it's a little, they're still toys kind of. They're not real tools, but that group at ATAP could definitely make that. Like ATAP does amazing stuff other than VR. They're making like watch radar and capacitive clothing, and you know, Project Aura was there, the phone that snapped together. So it's a really neat little skunkworksy office, you know, 3D printers and people drilling stuff, and so that's like the best place to be making VR tools, I think. So hopefully they're doing some of that now. I don't know.
Awesome. I love the film. I talked to a father about this movie, and he said that the film made him cry. And I'm just wondering whether you're a parent and whether that affected your storytelling at all.
I'm not. I don't have a dog, and I'm not a parent. But I'm going to be a parent in like 6 weeks, so soon.
Congratulations.
It's not my work. I mean, it is, but not the hard part. Yeah, we'll see. I don't know. No, I think you're always part of that relationship. You're at least the kid, you know? So hopefully it's simple and abstract enough that you can kind of insert yourself into it in some way, you know? I think it works. There's been a couple, you see a guy watching, you know, you watch it in the Vive and you kind of think you're alone at a conference or something like that. You take it off and it's like a grown man, tears coming down his face, and all of a sudden he's like, everybody's looking at him. Makes people uncomfortable, maybe.
Cool. We'll see if we can make some people cry in a bit. So any more questions? Yes? Awesome. Hang on.
So what are you working on now?
That's always good. I was hoping someone would ask that. I have a TV show on ABC coming out on after Fresh Off the Boat at 9:30 on Tuesdays on March 29th called Imaginary Mary. It's a live-action show. It's Alf-like. You know, there's a puppet-slash-animated character in the sitcom with Jenna Elfman. That came from a general meeting. You go in a lot of general meetings after a film which comes out of yours, which means you just meet producers, writers, people that might be able to help you make stuff. And if you have a conversation that sticks, sometimes things get made. And I met Doug Robinson, who produces The Goldbergs, and he introduced me to Adam Goldberg, who has a collection of all of my dad's toys, basically. Like a huge amount of Star Wars toys. And so we got along, talked about The Goldbergs, talked about making a show that had a little labyrinthy magic in it. And that's what we ended up with a year and a half later, after pitching it, you know, to the network. So there's that, and I'm directing a feature at Fox Animation called Nimona, based on a graphic novel by Noel Stevenson, who also did a book called Lumberjanes, And Mark Hames, who wrote Kubo and the Two Strings, is writing Nimona right now with me. We're a couple drafts in, and it's looking great. And it's such a cool... It's about a shapeshifter that takes place in the medieval future. It's knights and lasers, and it's like Game of Thrones meets Metroid, which I think is just awesome. And I can't wait for people to see that in several years. So, yeah, those two things, and then, you know, I'm pitching around other stuff still here and there, but the studio life in that is really different, but it's really fun. I drive around LA a lot now. So. Great. Enjoy the Vive version. It's such cool technology. I can't wait to see what other people start doing with this stuff. So, thank you very much.
Awesome.